10 o'clock hour. It's the shorts with Sister Araka. But we have a special guest in studio, somebody who people call up for even when he's not here. Dr. Anthony Montero, organizer of the Year of WEB initiative, joins us now, as he does every Wednesday in the 9 o'clock hour, to read classic literature from the renowned scholar W.E.B. Du Bois. Good morning, Doc.
Good morning. How are you,
my friend?
Chris.
Doc is in the building.
And my good friend, Ike Raw.
Ike Rizzo.
Oh, you see that? My good friend. You see
Ike Rizzo. You moved up to good friend.
Yeah, you see that?
And I'll go further. My colleague.
Oh.
Oh. See that? A colleague.
A colleague. You know, a PhD.
Yeah, right. Exactly. I like that.
Is it contagious? Can I get a PhD? <by sitting? laughs>
Most of them are worthless anyway.
I told somebody yesterday, PhD is short for Philadelphia.
Yeah,
Doc, what you got for us? This is the biggest W.E.B. Du Bois book that you've walked into the studio with.
Well, this is a book of essays,
okay.
So that's why it's so big. But first, I'd like to just make your audience aware of the fact that on April 28th at 6 to 9 p.m. at Mother Bethel.
That's next Saturday.
Yes, next Saturday at Mother Bethel AME Church, we're organizing a town hall forum called Blessed Are the Peacemakers.
Mm.
And it is a commemoration of the lives and works of Paul Robeson, W.E.B. Du Bois, and Martin Luther King Jr. And we're talking about peace because the world is on the cusp of war everywhere you look. And the United States is the main, as King said, the main purveyor of violence in the world. So we want to talk about these great figures.
It says April 28th.
April 28th.
Mother Bethel.
Mother Bethel.
Beginning at what time?
Church. Beginning at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
And
is it free event?
It's a free event. Open to the public.
You hear that, guys? Free event. April 28th. Mother Bethel. Get down there.
Six and
see Doc in person.
Well, you won't have to see me in person necessarily. What you will hear and see are the words of Paul Robeson.
Mm.
You know, Paul Robeson spent the last 10 years of his life here in Philadelphia. He died here, and
he died here.
Yeah, he died here.
I didn't know that.
And we don't know him.
Yeah.
We don't know.
I was just telling Ike that when we were at the 52nd Street Parkside event last Friday, and Barbara Atkins. I believe she's a curator or partner at the Paul Robeson House.
Oh, yes,
yeah.
Yes.
And she was just telling Ike, telling me that she wants me and Ike to come down and have a personal tour, because I haven't been there in years.
Oh, definitely.
And I've told that they remodeled the building and everything.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, Paul Robeson is a universe in himself.
Mm.
He spoke close to 25 languages.
Wow.
He was probably one of the greatest athletes of the 20th century.
I didn't even know he was an athlete. We're going to have a segment for you with W.E.B. Du Bois and then a segment on Paul Robeson.
Paul Robeson is so huge. That is why the erasure of him from our history and consciousness has been so thorough and ruthless.
Mm-hmm.
Because to know Paul Robeson is to know Afro-America in a way that we do not know ourselves.
How did Paul Robeson match intellectually and on an intellectual scale with Du Bois? Were they contemporaries?
They were. Well, Paul Robeson was born 30 years after Du Bois.
Mm-hmm.
So in a certain sense, Robeson is mentored by Du Bois.
Okay.
In the same way that Robeson mentored Harry Belafonte and Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee and Sidney
Poitier. All those cultural luminaries.
That's right.
The Harlem Renaissance and on.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The Harlem Renaissance is what catapults Paul Robeson into the international public mind.
Mm.
But then he becomes this great fighter for African independence and for black rights in this country. And he's brought before a Senate committee and accused, as was Du Bois, of being an agent of a foreign government.
Mm.
And Paul Robeson counts.
They just pull out that playbook on all of us, don't they?
All of us. We're all agents of a foreign government if you're an agent of black folk.
Mm.
Which raises some very interesting questions about who backs and supports who and what.
Mm.
You know, there are certain names that become well known and certain that are never spoken.
Mm-hmm.
And why certain names are never spoken is the question that we often have to ask if we are prepared to think courageously and critically. Mm. And so Paul Robeson is one of those people. And when you put Robeson together with Du Bois and with King, the question of world peace, and literally saying to black folk, why would you fight in the army of a government that does not fight for you? Or put it, you know.
That's a real question, though. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
When
oh,
I
yes.
meet, and I have respect for black soldiers, I have members of my family who have served. Mm. You know, one of my good friends is a Vietnam veteran, but I do often ask, what's the incentive?
Well, you know, I was drafted twice.
Really?
To go to Vietnam, and I refused to go.
I did not know that about you.
Wow. Yes.
Wow.
Yes. Did you go to prison?
No, I didn't go to prison, but I did, in an act of solidarity, go to North Vietnam.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Which was then considered the enemy of the United States.
Mm.
But I've always stood up for peace and against militarism and war, because I've always felt that war was the enemy of poor people.
Mm.
And, of course, with this expanding of the military budget
yeah.
under Trump by $57 billion, while schools are closing down, while black men are being harassed and beaten and killed by the police, while the prisons are expanding.
Well, I have to imagine that you feel...
It's a grotesque landscape that we live in.
And I have to imagine that you feel that way right now with Trump taking us essentially to war with Syria without even congressional approval.
No question.
And you're talking about poor people. That is the poorest of the poor in that area right now. They're already distressed. They're already disheveled. And now we're bombing them when, at the same time, Trump, the scumbag in chief, won't even let these people come into our country.
That's right. That's right. But, you know, the greater war that we don't even hear about are the wars in Africa, because mm-hmm. Africa is the mineral treasure house of the world. And, you know, the United States has military bases in 30 countries in Africa, as does France and England. So Africa is at war or having war enacted upon it by the Western nations. And that gets me to what I want to read today.
Okay.
This is an essay by W.E.B. Du Bois called The African Roots of War. And we'll see what it says. It's very interesting because, see, what Du Bois argues is that Africa has been the foundation of foreign wars, of aggression by the Western nations, because Africa has labor, because Africa has resources. And that's, I think, the case today. So let me just start and we'll see.
And now, what's the name of this essay?
It's called The African Roots of War.
Mm-hmm. And the name of the book that it's in?
It's an essay that was in The Atlantic.
Okay.
And I have a book, a very large book.
Wow.
Which is
you don't play no games, man. That is a big book, man. That's like a Bible.
Two Bibles.
Quran. You know? But it's a book of essays called the W.E.B. Du Bois Reader.
Wow.
And it's edited by David Levering Lewis.
Let us hear some, Doc.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. He starts with a Latin quote, Semper Novi Quid Ex Africa, which means always Africa's giving something new, cried the Roman proconsul. And he voiced the verdict of 4,000 years. Yet there are those who would write world history and leave out this most marvelous of continents. Particularly today, most men assume that Africa lies far afield from the centers of our burning social problems, and especially from our present problem of world war. Yet, in a very real sense, Africa is a prime cause of this terrible overturning of civilization which we have lived to see. And these words seek to show how in the African continent are hidden the roots, not simply of war today, but of the menace of wars tomorrow. Always Africa is giving us something new, or some reconfiguration of a world old thing. On its black bosom arose one of the earliest, if not the earliest, of self-protecting civilizations in Egypt, and grew so mightily that it still furnishes superlatives to thinking and speaking men. Out of its dark and more remote forest fastness came, if we may credit many recent scientists, the first welding of iron, and we know that agriculture and trade flourished there when Europe was a wilderness. nearly every human empire that has risen in the world, material and spiritual, has found some of its greatest crises on this continent of Africa, from Greece to Great Britain. With the Renaissance and the widened world of modern thought, Africa came no less suddenly with her new old gifts. So much for the past, and now today. The Berlin Conference to apportion the rising riches of Africa among the white peoples met on the 15th day of November in 1884. 11 days earlier, three Germans left Zanzibar, whither they had gone secretly disguised as mechanics. And before the Berlin Conference had finished its deliberation, they had annexed to Germany and over half as large again as the whole German Empire in Europe. Only in its dramatic suddenness was this undisguised robbery of the land of 7 million people different from the methods by which Great Britain and France got 4 million square miles each, Portugal 750,000, and Italy and Spain smaller but substantial areas. In other words, when we see Africa carved up among 54 nations, this is the result of the partitioning of Africa among colonial powers. Mm. The methods by which the continent has been stolen have been contemptible and dishonest beyond expression. Lying treaties, rivers of rum, murder, assassination, mutilation, rape, and torture have marked the progress of Englishmen, German, Frenchmen, and Belgian on the African continent. The only way in which the world has been able to endure the horrible tale is by deliberately closing its ears and changing the subject of conversation while the deviltry went on. And thus he continues. Thus the world began to invest in color prejudice. The color line began to pay dividends. For indeed, while the exploration of the Valley of the Congo was the occasion of the scramble for Africa, the cause lay deeper. The Franco-Prussian War turned the eyes of those who sought power and dominion away from Europe. Already, England was in Africa, cleaning away the debris of the slave trade and half-consciously groping towards the new imperialism. France, humiliated and impoverished, looked towards a new northern African empire sweeping from the Atlantic to the Red Sea. And finally, he asked the question, what stake do white people have in the exploitation and colonization of Africa? And he says, the theory of this new democratic despotism has not been clearly formulated. Most philosophers see the ship of state launched on the broad, irresistible tide of democracy, with only delaying eddies here and there. Others, looking closer, are more disturbed. Are we, they ask, reverting to aristocracy and despotism, as we are today? The rule of might, they cry out and then rub their eyes, for surely they cannot fail to see strengthening democracy all about them. It is this paradox which has confounded philanthropists, curiously betrayed the socialists and reconciled the imperialists and captains of industry to any amount of democracy. It is this paradox which allows in America the most rapid advance of democracy to go hand in hand in its very centers with increased aristocracy and hatred towards darker races, and which excuses and defends an inhumanity that does not shrink from the public burning of human beings and their lynching. Mm. I'll stop there.
Wow. We got to take a break. I see Tyrone from North Philly, Joseph from Massachusetts, and of course, Brother Timothy from South Philly, who I think just may be your biggest fan.
Okay.
It's 9:43. We're going to go to break, and when we come back, we'll let you, our listening audience, interact with the doc. I'm Flood the Drummer in studio with Ike Rock, Wace Mathis, and Anthony Montero, PhD and organizer of the Year of Du Bois. We'll be right back.
Seems like everything has a day. There's even a National Cheesesteak Day, which, come on, that's pretty much every day here. But AARP in Philadelphia thinks today should be your day. So come meet new people at free movie screenings and festivals, or help make a difference by volunteering with us. Whatever you decide to do, we got you. We're here in our community helping you make the most of it. So take on today and every day. Cheapsteak in hand with AARP. Learn how at aarp.org/Philadelphia.
Listen to Laborers Live.
We created the weekend. We created the 40-hour work week. We just want enough to feed our family, be able to send our children to college, and let our next generation do better than we did.
To people that might have forgot how important unionism is in this country like the United States. People now infringing on our 8-hour work day, kind of work people more than 8 hours without overtime, kind of work people without benefits. In the long run, everybody's getting a fat paycheck except the workers. So this is really a wake-up call for America.
The struggle is continuous. Tune in to Laborers Live every Friday from 4 to 5 p.m. Sponsored by LESSIT, the Laborers Employers Cooperation Education Trust of the Laborers District Council of Philadelphia and Vicinity.
Local 332, Sam Staten Jr. Business Manager. Local 57, Esteban Vera Business Manager. Local 135, Dan Woodall Jr. Business Manager. Local 413, James Harper Jr. Business Manager. The Laborers District Council, Ryan Boyer Business Manager. And Tony Staten, Executive Director of LESSIT.
Many home care agencies exist in the Delaware Valley, but only one agency stands alone. That's Ori Home Care. Call us today at 215-398-1001. We stand alone because family members and friends can be paid to provide care to your loved ones, paid time off, and medical benefits available after 90 days. Life insurance available for full-time employees. You're paid weekly. We're with you from the beginning of the enrollment process to the end. So call Ori Home Care today for enrollment information at 215-398-1001. Ori Home Care, because we stand alone.
You're listening to Wake Up With WURD on WURD Radio, 96.1 FM and 900 AM WURD, independent black media.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome back to Wake Up With WURD. It's 9:45. Coming up at 10 o'clock, it's The Source with Sister Araka, so stay tuned. We have on the line people who want to talk with you, Doc. Who's first? Is that Brother Tyrone from North Philly? Good morning and welcome to the show.
Hey, y'all. Good morning. Hey, Doc.
Good morning.
Love y'all brothers, man.
We love you too, man.
Hey, look. Man, that little role play y'all did today, y'all might as well create another segment called Soap with Ike and Flood. Populated by Koisha.
I like that.
Hey, man, I'm telling you, y'all were on point. But look, first, man, I want to just give a little shout-out and a little thanks for my WURD family. Everybody mm-hmm. that was with me yesterday, Brother Jeff, you know, grabbing me and just, you know, stand up black man. And Brother Ryan giving me the power sign. I'm telling you, I love my family. I love my WURD family. And also, you know, keepers of the culture. Because, you know, my grandson, I had just signed him up because that boy can tell some stories. But look, man, I want to just call to just say one thing I asked yesterday, and I'm going to ask it again today.
Okay.
And by the good doctor, maybe the doc can maybe jump on this too. Does it make a difference that the CEOs and everybody is coming, trying to change the dynamic of, again, how black folks are treated in this country?
Okay, fair question. I'll let the hang up so you can listen. We'll let
thank you for allowing me to share.
Oh, of course, anytime, Brother Tyrone. We love you too, and our condolences to your family as you're going through this really tough time.
No, he's a good brother. It ain't tough.
Yes, sir.
Just moved on. It ain't tough. I'm letting you know that, you know, because we are all good.
Absolutely. Good. I appreciate that.
Yep. Thanks, Brother Tyrone.
All right, brother.
All right.
Doctor, do you want to respond at all?
Oh, yeah, you know what, and my condolences, Ty. But, you know, yes, what has changed? The substance of things are what they have always been.
Mm.
The dynamic of white privilege and black oppression.
Mm.
You know, literally, you know, I was out a couple days ago, and it just struck me. As I watched white people in Center City
mm-hmm.
and I guess around Rittenhouse Square,
yeah.
You know, what Starbucks is. And it struck me that their happiness and their comfort is based upon our unhappiness and our oppression. And, you know, that's what Du Bois is talking about in this essay, the African roots of war, not just war abroad, but war on black people here in the United States. So nothing has changed. Maybe the window dressing, but not the substance.
Well, I thought racism ended Monday when it did the sit-ins and all that stuff. Yeah.
No. Oh, I mean, according to our beloved police commissioner, Richard Ross, we have equitable policing in the city, Doc, and nothing less will be tolerated.
Well, it's equitable because he's the police chief. I mean, if he's not the police chief, will it still be equitable?
Yeah.
No, we have to get to the substance of matters, not window dressing, not symbols.
Now, you've been in Philly all your life.
All my life.
Have you ever seen equitable policing?
I've never seen equitable anything.
Yes, Doc! Get him, Doc! He said the damn with the policing. I don't even know what equitable is in this city.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Brother Joseph, good morning from Massachusetts and welcome to the show.
Joseph from Worcester, Massachusetts. How y'all doing? How the doctors doing?
We're good.
Good morning, Brother Joe.
Good morning.
Doc, before I ask you a direct question about WEB the board, you know, our problem is because the power structure has us only talk about Dr. Martin Luther King or Malcolm X, which is two good men. For instance, I'm a Paul Robeson lover, a WEB the board lover. I read, this is my seventh book I read on Paul Robeson. I'm going to show you how it's connected to our problem. Right now, I read about the Spanish Civil War. You know how many black people call it under the Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, Lincoln Brigade that sacrificed their life in the Spanish War? Paul Robeson went there. He didn't fight, but he gave moral support. And this is what Ernest Hemingway was there. You talk about Africa, this and that. Do you know Africa, largest trading partner is China, $160 billion. China's building hospital, railroad. They're building all kinds of things all over Africa. So I think we need to do what W.E.B. Du Bois and Paul Robeson and all great black thinkers did in the past. You got to overpass America, even though you don't have to keep telling people you love America, but you got to show what other countries are doing to uplift Africa. Like China. Now, the direct option, our problem with W.E.B. Du Bois, what I want to talk about. The last book I read, one book was, it's called The Professor and the Scholar, Professor and the Pupil, W.E.B. Du Bois and Paul Robeson, which had a thing. Our problem is we don't know what W.E.B. Du Bois really stands for, simply because he was an atheist and a communist, and Paul Robeson was a communist. And because of that, our black leaders are not telling the young people something to work with. So the direct question is, I left Great Barrington, Massachusetts, good place, birthplace of W.E.B. Du Bois. They wanted to put up a statue of him 2 years ago, they turned it down. Now there's big correlation going on. But the people that uplifted W.E.B. Du Bois are not black people or white people. A lot of them are Jewish. They're going to take the narrative, they're going to tell the story in City Hall down there, in Town Hall in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. So it's a direct question to you. Isn't that why the police killing us? Isn't that why we're not getting justice? Because our black leaders are failing us by not talking about the great hard work W.E.B. Du Bois do. I got to listen to your comments.
You know, thank you very much. You know, and I cannot express my gratefulness to, you know, to Chris and Ike and Bois, and to the station for allowing me to read the words of W.E.B. Du Bois.
We love it.
Yeah, really. And to make his life and that of Robeson a part of the spiritual life of black Philadelphia. We need this.
Absolutely.
We need this very, very badly, because a ship without a rudder, a ship without a direction, without a purpose, just keeps going around in circles. And over the last 40 or 50 years, we as a people have been going around in circles without a direction. I would just recharacterize Robeson and Du Bois differently than the caller. They were freedom fighters all of their lives. They chose to align with revolutionary and freedom fighters throughout the world. And this is what we have to know. They were attacked. Paul Robeson's name has been taken out of our memory. He is not taught in universities, in schools, in churches.
I never learned about
prison.
Him.
No.
In grade school.
Although
never.
He died in Philadelphia.
Wow.
One of the greatest athletes of the 20th century. The greatest singer.
I need you on the school board, Doc. What's up, man?
Well, it's
he's gonna get started. Right, we go. he couldn't get it out. Brother Timothy, y'all last caller for this segment. Good morning, welcome to the show. If I get Doc in trouble.
Yes. Good morning, sir. I have been a fan of Dr. Montero at least for 25 years. Dr. Montero and myself met at Boober's Bookshop with a group of other brothers. Man, they used to sit down and talk about Republican politics and Democratic politics and third party politics and stuff like that. But I'm also going to comment on you, my brother, Flood, and
yes,
you also, Ike. I'm going to say this, man, that your work is very much noticed.
Right. Wow.
You two are like a general on the radio. When it comes to the street, you're in the foxhole.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get it wrong, man. Don't get it twisted. And I'm going to say something about Tony Montero.
Mm-hmm.
Tony Montero did not ride Du Bois for fame and fortune.
Mm.
Tony Montero, if it was a thing, such thing as a recreation, he is Dr. Du Bois.
Mm.
No, Tim, I have to disagree with you there. I am not.
You can't fill those shoes.
Man, I'm going to get into something, Tony. I'm going to talk about some of Du Bois' life as far as the professor at Wilberforce on the staff at Penn and at Clark Atlanta University and eventually running for office for Senate, getting over 2,000 votes. And
W.E.B. Du Bois ran for office?
Yeah, he ran for the U.S. Senate from New York.
Yeah. Oh, we got to talk about that next week. Yeah. I'm learning so much. I had no idea he was interested in. And that was also, anyway, we'll dive.
By the way, Timothy. By the way, hey, Timothy, if I might interrupt you just since we mentioned that, he ran on a third-party ticket.
Okay.
After World War II, he had come to the conclusion that neither Democratic or Republican parties stood for the interests of black people or for the interest of world peace. In 1952, he publicly stated that he would not vote in the presidential election because neither Republicans or Democrats, Eisenhower or Stevenson,
deserved
the vote of black people.
Mm.
And Paul Robeson took a similar position. They argued that the only way for black politics to go was independent of the Democratic and Republican parties.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we would be going around in a circle looking for solutions where solutions did not exist.
Mm. Brother Timothy, we're going to give you 90 seconds.
No problem. And I can't forget my girl, Kawaisa. But just recently, Dr. Montero, I had been reading some of the writings of Grace Lee Boggs and her husband, James Boggs.
Right.
And they did a chapter on King and also Malcolm X.
Mm-hmm.
And in her chapter on the both of them, she talked about how the evolutions were in the chains. In other words, whites were worried about locking arms in the South with the whites and the blacks. And they didn't like King when he was doing that. The liberals didn't want him to go so fast. They didn't want to really go to Washington. They thought he was going in a direction that was just moving too fast as far as the system was concerned. But she also talked about the development and evolution of Malcolm. And she also talked about how when Malcolm B was hanging with Castro and Malcolm's connection with socialists, he was going in such a fast direction. I'm going to say this to you. Du Bois was married twice. Mm-hmm. He had a long life. He wrote out Crisis. He was with Ida B. Wells and Dr. Julia Cooper.
Mm-hmm.
And the shortening of King's life and Malcolm's life, what would they have been if they would have reached at least 75? I think we'd be in a better prediction.
And I'll just say quickly, you know, when Malcolm was in prison, he had two heroes, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and Paul Robeson.
Really?
Yes. And when he got out of prison, Paul Robeson was under severe attack by the government.
Mm-hmm.
So Malcolm, I don't think, ever met him. But he did have the opportunity to go and meet and then become a member of the Nation of Islam.
Wow. All right. Matt, you want to say something?
No, people was asking where the 9th District went at 67%.
Oh, that's Rittenhouse Square.
Right, because people were saying that the 9th District, they think you're speaking, you know, council-wise. Like,
oh, no, 9th Police District.
Right,
yes,
right.
Thank you for the clarification. The 9th Police District in Rittenhouse Square is where 67% of African Americans are stopped by police, even though they make up only 3% of the population. And, Doc, look, I'm comfortable because I know that by the day of tomorrow, somebody in city council is going to have a press conference to address
this. That's right. Absolutely. And they should say, this constitutes a crime against black people.
Mm.
Literally.
And a constitutional crisis.
That's right. A constitutional
and drama.
Crisis. And drama. So we just gave you the word, city council. It's a constitutional crisis.
And drama.
Thanks, everybody who came and called in, tweeted, and made today's show what it was. Shout out to, Shout out to Philadelphia District Attorney Larry Krasner, who joined the show for an exclusive Q&A. Shout out to Professor Aaron Smith of Temple University, who joined us to talk about the class he teaches on Meek Mill. Much thanks to everybody who called in and tweeted. You guys have made this one of the most, if not the most, interactive show on Word Radio.
Yes.
And, of course, much love to Dr. Anthony Montero, organizer of the Year of Du Bois Initiative, who joins the show every Wednesday to read the classic literature from W.E.B. Du Bois, a renowned scholar, and as I learned today, a budding politician. It's 9:59. Stay tuned to The Source. Good morning.
Thanks, man.
Let's talk about how